Thank you for the praise and prayer. And we are in the midst of studying the sixth book in the History of Redemption series, the Eternal High Priest of the Covenantal Oath. And today, last time, we spent 2 weeks in studying the genealogy of the high priests, 77 generations. And today we're going to study about the garments of the high priest. And the garments are very important because it's emphasized in the Bible, and especially Exodus chapter 28, verses 1 through 43. God gives specific and special instructions for the garments of the high priest to be made in specific ways, and commanded for these garments to be worn by the high priest, especially when the high priest is doing God's work. So let us think about the garments of the high priest, and think about the garments of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is our eternal high priest. So let us read our main passage first, Exodus chapter 28, verses 3 through 6. Of course, the entire chapter, verses 1 through 43, is our main passage, but we will only read these four verses. So shall we read together? We'll read alternatively, responsibly. I'll read verse 3, you can read verse 4, and so on. So I'll read verse 3. You shall speak to all the skillful persons whom I have endowed with the spirit of wisdom, that they make Aaron's garments to consecrate him, that he may minister as priest to me. They shall take the gold and the blue and the purple and the scarlet material and the fine linen. They shall also make the ephod of gold, of blue and purple and scarlet material and fine twisted linen, the work of the skillful workmen. This is the word of God. Amen. Verse 3 and verse 4, God continues to say, at the end of verse 3, it says, do this, basically make Aaron's garments, so that he may minister as priest to me. So as if without these garments, he cannot minister to God, right? And verse 4 again, Aaron, at the bottom of verse 4, it says that he may minister as priest to me. So these garments are very important in ministering to God. And I sincerely pray that you and I may receive these garments and put on these garments in the end, or in our life today, in our life of faith, so that we may be qualified to minister to God. Amen? So where do we get these garments? So let us think about these garments. But before we think about the high priest's garments, let us think about some garments that appear in the Bible, throughout the Bible. Garments play an important role in God's redemptive work. We can think about Adam's garments. Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. After Adam sinned, the protection of God's glory around Adam and Eve were taken away. Basically, Adam rejected the word of God, the bright light of God, God's glory, and they were on their own, and as a result, they saw each other's and their own shame. They knew that they were naked. They put on the garment of fig leaves, okay, which did not last very long. So God made a garment of skin for them, and that garment was called ketonet, okay? Garment of skin. Garment of skin required a sacrifice of an animal. This foreshadows sacrifice of Jesus, who was our lamb, who took off his garment, his covering, for us. And atonement means covering. Atonement, Jesus atoned for our sins. That means covering. He covered our shame. Second, we can think about Joseph's garment, the varicolored tunic. And that word tunic is also ketonet in Hebrew. And it was Jacob, his father, who gave him special garment to designate that he is the chosen son who will fulfill the will of God's work of redemption. And his garment was torn in pieces and bloodstained, foreshadowing, again, Jesus, who will also be torn and bloodstained. We can think about Elijah's garment also, Elijah's tunic, which he used to part the Jordan River, right? It was a garment of power. And later, Jesus' garment, like the woman with hemorrhage, only touched the tassel of the garment, the corner of the garment, and she was healed. It's the garment of power. And garment of healing, just as I just mentioned, Matthew 9, 28 and 21. And then we can think about Jesus' garments on the cross. According to John chapter 19, verses 23 and 24, Jesus had the outer garment and the inner garment. The outer garment, Jesus was stripped of both garments, the outer and the inner. The outer garment was torn in four pieces, and they were taken to four different places, representing the four Gospels, or the Word of God being spread out to all four directions to cover the world. But then there is one piece garment, which is the tunic inside, and that speaks about the inner, the core of God's Word that stays as one, right? Just as the river comes, one river was in the Garden of Eden, it comes out and flows into four different rivers. Jesus' word, the core of God's word, comes out into four different directions. Okay? And so, the garments, now you can probably get an idea. Garments represent the covering, the forgiveness, atonement work of Jesus. These garments represent the power and healing work of Jesus. These garments represent the Gospels and the Word that covers this world. Okay? And then in Revelation, we see the fine linen worn by the saints of God. And these are the garments that you and I need to somehow find and spiritually and put on. The high priest's garments were instructed by God in design and purpose. It's not made according to human thought, human design, or according to what we think would look nice. And these garments represent, especially the fine linen, according to Revelation chapter 19, verse 8, is the deeds of the saints. And so, putting on the garment in the biblical sense, putting on the garment is actually doing things in our deeds, action, and words. Okay? And so, when I say I'm putting on the priest's garment, it means I am doing the task of the priest. That's the connotation. So how do we put on the garment? By our life that we live, that we do. And so when we say garments are designed and made according to God's will, and we need to put them on in the right order according to God's design, meaning we have to, our life of faith needs to proceed and our deeds need to follow the design of God, not what I think is the right order, not according to what I think looks more fashionable. Okay? Speaks about the way we do things in our life of faith. You understand? Okay, let's go on. So these are some of the Bible verses. Let us think about the high priest. This is the high priest. Okay. Okay, let's put some garments on him. Supposed to be naked, but you know, we have children, we have men and women. Okay, put on the first piece of garment here, and it's called the linen breeches, boxers, or underwear. Okay, linen breeches. It was the garment that was closest to the bare skin, and it was worn to cover his bare skin. Okay, let us not just think about physical garment pieces and purpose, but let us think about our spiritual way of putting on or becoming a priest, royal priest, according to 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, so that we are able and we are ready to minister to God. Okay, what do we need to do in order to minister to God? First, we have to put on the linen breeches. To do what? To cover our shame. First thing we need to do when we come to Christ, our sins need to be covered. Our sins, our shame needs to be washed away. And so this speaks about our first step, which is repentance. Receiving the blood of Jesus Christ to cover our sins. Exodus 28, verse 42. You shall make for them linen breeches to cover their bare flesh. They shall reach from the loins even to the thighs. So Reverend Abraham Park, who is the author of this book, went through every single verse and combination or different you know, books, the Leviticus, Deuteronomy, Exodus, to make sure that these drawings, even these drawings, are according to the Bible, accurate to the Bible. Adam and Eve were ashamed, and they found themselves naked after sinning. Jesus was stripped naked to cover our shame. He was, all these cross drawings and crucifixion drawings have some kind of piece of garment on him, but in the Bible tells us he was completely naked on the cross. To show, he took our shame to cover our shame of sin. Reference verse, Ezekiel 23, verse 18. And after the linen breeches was the tunic, and this is in Hebrew, ketonet. Tunic, both the breeches and the tunic were made of fine linen. Fine linen represents purity. And so even though we were ashamed, stained with sin, through our repentance, when we come to Jesus, he cleans us pure and white and covers our shame with his purity. Not only the breeches, but now the whole body. This fine linen signifies the righteous acts of the saints. And you and we should know, but just in case we do not know, the Bible tells us, you and I as human beings cannot be pure and righteous on our own. It's only through the blood of Jesus Christ, only through the grace and forgiveness of Jesus Christ that you and I can be pure. But if we are apart, away from the blood of Jesus Christ, just one day, or just half a day, just 1 hour, just 1 minute, we become stained with sin right away. Right away. And so we need to come to the cross, come to the blood constantly to be washed. There were friends or even myself when we used to say, why take a shower? Because why take a shower tonight? When you go home tonight, are you going to take a shower? Wash yourselves? I hope you do. But then my argument was, why take a shower? I'll take another shower the next morning. I get dirty anyway. Why take a shower? Is that a strong argument? Don't you agree? Why take a shower tonight? Since I'm going to sweat and get dirty tonight again after taking a shower. and I'm going to take a shower tomorrow morning again, anyway. Hey, why eat? You get hungry anyway. You're going to eat tomorrow again. Why eat now? See? But same thing with our repentance. Why repent right now? Just culminate some sins and then repent all together at the end. Why not? No. So we need to continue. We need to put on this garment. Without this repentance and becoming pure, we cannot put on the next garment. That's the problem. Okay? So Isaiah 64 verse 6, our righteous deeds are like filthy garments. Right? Our definition, our own righteousness is like filthy garments. We need to have this garment of Jesus Christ put onto us, not our righteous deeds, but His righteous deeds. Romans 13:14, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts. Amen. And some other reference verses, Romans 5:17 through 21, 1 Corinthians 1:30, Philippians 1:11, and 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. And then linen sash, not linen sash, sash over the linen tunic. Supposed to be from waist down to the ankle, according to the Talmud. Because the tunic is one piece, seamless, it needs a sash. For men, we might not know, but women who wear dress, one-piece dress, if it's big enough, it will be quite free, and it's not easy to do a lot of work in a dress. So the Bible says, gird yourself, especially when you're about to go somewhere and do God's or do work. So it needs a sash. The materials used: fine twisted linen, blue, purple, and scarlet material. These represent the things that we need in order to become saints, in order to become people of God. I call it heavenly ingredients. These colors representing purity, representing heaven, representing His kingship, representing the blood of Jesus Christ. And so we put on the linen breeches, repentance, being purified, and then we put on the tunic, linen tunic, to cover our entire body. Basically, our entire body starts to be purified. Our deeds become more righteous. When we come to Jesus, we receive forgiveness to our sins. Our life starts to change. And once our life starts to change to His righteousness, the next thing we need to do, we are going to start doing His work. That's why we need the sash. Okay? We put on the sash. We put on other things that we need in order to be called workers of God or ministers of God. And this sash is sometimes called the sash of task, because the tunic is like a dress. It is difficult to work in it without the sash. Exodus 12:11, now you shall eat it in this manner, with your loins girded. When during Passover, God said, eat the meat, Passover lamb, with your loins girded. Why? Right after you finish eating, you're going to go. Exodus. Right? And so in order to go or move or do work for God, we need to put on the spiritual sash. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 13 says, therefore, prepare your minds for action. Literally, it says, gird the loins of your mind. Don't be complacent. Be sober. Keep sober in spirit. Fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Christ Jesus Christ. Now, God is wanting to pour upon you His grace and His spirit. But in order to receive that grace, we need to be alert and awake spiritually. We need to gird up the loins of our minds. God wants to give us work to do so that His will may be fulfilled. And He will do it to those who are girded up in the loins of their minds. But if we're complacent, in debauchery, we're not sober, drunk, in the addictions of this world, we're confused in the mix of the different doctrines and teachings of this world, we're not girded up. And God cannot do His work through us. So I pray, Zion, that we may gird the loins of our minds. The time is coming. What time? The time for us to... Or should I say, time is running out? What time? The time for us to do God's work. Either way you look at it, we need to hurry up and gird up the loins of our minds so that we may receive the grace and blessings that He gives us, so that we can get up and do the work that would glorify Him, that He wants us to fulfill. Luke 12:35-37, be dressed in readiness and keep your lamps lit. Be like men who are waiting for their master when He returns. He says He's coming back, but be dressed. Be girded up. And then the turban on the head. For the normal, regular priests, only the high priest wears a turban. The other priests wear what is called a cap. Okay? And it's shaped differently. Cap looks more like a cone head kind of thing. The turban is more like mushroom. Okay. Misnefet is the name for the turban, and it means to wrap around. Wrap around your head. Get your head wrapped around. What does that sound like? Okay. It's made of fine linen again, work of a weaver. And on the front, there's a band, golden band. Okay. It says, Kadosh LeYahweh, meaning holy to the Lord, or to Yahweh. Holiness to Yahweh. Leviticus chapter 8, verse 9, He also placed the turban on His head, and on the turban at its front, He placed the golden plate, the holy crown, just as the Lord had commanded Moses. The engraving on the golden plate, holy to the Lord, Kadosh, or Kodesh LeYahweh, it is to be fastened to the turban with a blue cord. Covering the head signifies covering one's own thoughts of flesh completely before God's word. Priests or people who are ready to minister to God need to have their head wrapped around with this fine linen, with the purity of Jesus and with the golden band. Gold represents something that does not change. So gold represents eternity. In the tabernacle, there's a lot of gold because it represents eternity. Okay? And so to cover the head means cover up my own thoughts, and what we need to follow, our head is Jesus Christ. And forehead, it means my path, my forward, the first thing that goes when I walk. Okay? We say, I am headed that way, right? What does that mean? I am headed that way. My head is going that way, right? What leads me is my head, my forehead. Okay? And what should be on my forehead? Meaning purpose, goal, direction, and the end of my walking, my life, holy to the Lord. Holiness to the Lord is my purpose, is my goal, is my direction. Do you see the steps? Can we review so far? First, what was the first? linen breeches, repentance. Second, tunic. What does that mean? Righteous acts, following the Lord. And then, sash. Good, good, good. Sash, ready to do God's work. Right? And then, when we are doing God's work, whose ways? My way? I did it my way? No, God's ways. Right? For the purpose of holy to the Lord, doing God's work. And then, over the tunic, this blue, when you see blue here, you can think heaven, heavenly. Blue represents the sky, right? It's the color of the sky. It speaks about the heavenly realm. Okay? So upon my righteous acts, he puts on what is heavenly. And I think it's glorious from this moment. It's so glorious if we can receive this kind of garment upon our life. Robe of the ephod. Garment worn right below the ephod. Okay. No design, just pure blue. If the righteous acts are our acts on this earth, on top of the over the righteous acts are the heavenly spiritual understanding, spiritual actions or life. Okay. It's a bit longer than it's longer than the ephod. We'll talk about the ephod right after this. Okay. And it's one piece, seamless. Blue, high priest power and authority. Blue also represents life and vitality. So I sincerely pray that upon our righteous acts, which is given by Jesus also, that he would robe us or cover us with the heavenly vitality and life and understanding of the spiritual life. Pomegranates of blue and purple and scarlet material all around on its hem. You can see at the bottom, the hem. Okay. So pomegranates represent prosperity in the Bible. Spiritual and physical, but more so in doing God's work. Overflowing fruits of prosperity. And bells of gold between them all around alternately. So these bells make sound. And when the high priests do their work outside the temple, people hear the sound of the bell. And they're called golden bell. Right? And the sound of the golden bell gives joy not only to God, but to the people, realizing it's the sound of good news. Sound of good news, the gospel. Right? Oh, my high priest is at work. That means my sins are being washed away. It's the sound of Jesus at work. And I pray, sincerely pray, that as we do our work, as we pray, the world will hear the sound of good news, that their sins are being washed away. Amen? Does the church have more, do you hear more good news or more bad news in the church? We hear more prayer requests. And so oftentimes prayer requests are not so good news. Somebody got sick. Somebody has cancer. Somebody got in an accident. We hear all these. But however, through those prayers, I pray that there will be good news coming out. And let us practice in our life to speak more good news than bad news. Amen? May there be more praises coming out of these lips than complaints. Yeah, amen? More, as much as prayer requests, we do need to share our prayer requests. May there be praise reports also coming out. Amen? Cell group leaders, this is my chance to remind you, you do need to report, give me cell group reports of your cell group meetings. And oftentimes we have prayer requests. And I appreciate that because that's sometimes, or most of the times, I refer to those prayer requests to pray for members. And may there be praise reports too. Amen. In the cell groups, cell group gatherings or small group gatherings, sometimes we get burdened after the meeting. Every member gets burdened with all the requests and prayer topics. But may there be also refreshing moments and gatherings where everybody just praises and gives thanks to God together for each other's praise reports, encouragements. Next is ephod. After all those pieces, then we are finally able to put on the ephod. Ephod is probably the most, this is like the climax. The purpose of putting on the others is to put on the ephod, okay? Holy garment that the priest needs to wear when he is performing his duties. Made with gold, blue, purple, scarlet, and fine linen, fine twisted linen. Only the high priest's ephod is this colorful. The other priest's ephod is just fine linen, white color. He's the phrase, he is wearing the ephod, means he became a priest. Okay. Kind of like in the United States, he is now living in the White House, means he became the president, right? So White House represents presidency. Ephod represents priesthood, okay? He's fulfilling his duties as priest. Ephod was considered as important as the Ark of the Covenant. Okay? See, the center, the core of the entire tabernacle was the Ark of the Covenant. All these priestly garments, high priest garments, you lay it out, it's just like the tabernacle. And at the center of it is the ephod, just like the Ark of the Covenant. And then on top of the, if you can see the difference between this picture and this picture. Do you see it? It's camouflage. This picture. Okay? And that's the band, like the sash of the ephod. Again, likewise, just like the sash inside, to do God's work. Skillfully woven band to be worn around the waist over the ephod. Same material as the ephod. The Lord who continues to work in the history of redemption. And that's what it foreshadows. And this ephod of the high priest is the ephod of Jesus Christ. And he is still at work. Jesus came to this earth and he said to everyone, my Father is at work. And we can confidently say Jesus is still at work. Amen? And I pray that you and I can live our lives to show the world that Jesus is at work to atone for people even today. Eighth, breastpiece of judgment. On the breast, there is a square breastplate, square, 22.5 centimeters by 22.5 centimeters. Square, same length and same width or height, means justice in judgment. God is just. Okay. 12 stones to represent the 12 tribes, and all 12 tribes represent the people of God. On God's heart, on God's breast. Okay. On the other side, inside, there's a little pocket, and there were Urim and Thummim, two stones, white and black, and these stones represent the will of God, and they are used to discern God's will in important issues and moments. Conclusion. Let us turn to Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 through 16. Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 through 16. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and wages war. His eyes are a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems, and he has a name written on him, which no one knows except himself. He is clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. I'll stop there. The Lord is coming back to us, and he is wearing a certain garment. Garment represents his deeds also. We have to understand the garments correctly in order for us to understand and recognize who Jesus is. Remember, Jesus came and people said, "Who are you?" Even John the Baptist said, "Are you the one, or should we wait for another?" What did Jesus tell them every time? Jesus told them, "Look at what I'm doing." And that's what the Bible, Old Testament, prophesied. To make the lame walk, to bring life, to heal the sick, right? Look at what I'm doing. Okay? Understanding the garments will allow us to see what God is doing. When we understand and see what God is doing today, that will tell us and allow us to understand what kind of time we are living in. That's why it's important. Let us turn to another passage. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. So as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion. These are the garments that you and I need to wear and put on. What? Put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bearing with one another and forgiving each other. Whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you. So, we put on our garments, linen breeches, the tunic, sash, and so on, so that we can minister to God, so that we can come into the presence of God. I sincerely pray, I would like to challenge you that we put on garments to other people too. I'll talk about this later, but this time when I went to the pastor's conference, there was a person, a brother, who came, and somebody introduced me. This person was a homeless. But brothers and sisters of Christ took this man from the streets, washed him, put on new clothes, because at first, when they found him, they couldn't come close to him because of the stench. He hadn't showered. He did not have new clothes. So they washed him, put on new clothes, and now he's training to become a minister of God. Sometimes when we see other people's shame, when we smell these people's stench, when we see Or when we see their dirtiness, we point fingers or we step back. Even in church, when we see other people's shame, we gossip about it or we try to stay away. But can we be the ones that can wash them, put on the linen breeches to cover their shame? And that's what Jesus wants us to do. That's the path of the cross. Not only put on garments for our own selves, but now that we have our own garments to cover our shame, can we put on the garments for them, for others, for each other? The order of putting on the garments, similar to entering the tabernacle. We learned about the tabernacle long enough, right? Through the door, the first thing you see is the altar for offering. And that represents the cross, where our sins are washed away, just like the linen breeches. Right? And then you go to the laver, the water basin, where our deeds are cleansed, righteous, and so on. And so the order is similar to the to entering the tabernacle all the way to the Ark of the Covenant. Process of sanctification to stand before the presence of God the Father. Repentance and atonement. Righteous deeds. Justification. Sanctification. And final judgment. And so I sincerely pray that you and I may be able to put on these garments. Jesus gave us those garments. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And not only stop there, but may we be able to put this garment on others, to each other, to this world, so that they can come into the presence of our Father. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for giving us this time to think about the garments that you gave to the priests to wear so that they can minister to you. Father, we want to put on these garments, the garments that Jesus was stripped off of, so that these garments can be given to us. Help us to follow you. Just like Elisha said, give me more power. And received the tunic of Elijah and was able to do the same things that Elijah did. We believe that you, Jesus, have given us your tunic so that we can do the same thing that you did, atoning for others, covering the shames of others with your garment. So, Father, please allow us to understand this word so that when you come again in blood-stained tunic that is dipped in blood, that we can recognize you through your deeds, your word. And Father, help us to receive this garment so that we can understand your word. Thank you so much for your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give thanks to God.